thank you very much, and thanks to Raphael for inviting me to the talk here. So this is probably one of the blandest titles I've ever given for a talk, so I set myself up to give a very bland talk as well, perhaps. So generally, I'm looking at the theme on canonical scattering, and I've decided that this is something that would be a suitable topic. So here are four different pictures of what I regard as being scattering by finite periodic arrays. So perhaps starting in the left-hand corner, that's the one I'll be thinking of in terms of setting up the theory initially. So this is a system whereby you've got a wave coming in from the left and being scattered from the left-hand edge by a series of circular cylinders. This might be an acoustic problem, that's what I'm thinking of. So governed by the wave, two-dimensional wave equation. There are n rows, and they extend periodically in the vertical direction to infinity. Okay, so the periodicity, or the finite periodicity that I'm thinking about here, is from left to right. Other people might be interested in other things, so if you just move down from that into the bottom left-hand corner, I've just got one such row, so this is where you've just got a single line of cylinders. This is something that would be of interest to people like Ian at the back, and Luke and Michael as well. The example that I'm going to give is the one in the top right-hand corner, which is a problem that I've looked at recently with my postdoc, which is on a water wave problem where you have surface gravity waves coming in from the left, and they're scattered by a finite periodic array of vertical barriers. So some of the energy, this is an incompressible fluid, and the wave energy is carried by the surface, and some of the energy passes underneath that, and this has some interesting effects. But then you can go fully three-dimensional as well. So this final picture that I've got in the bottom right-hand corner is something that I'm working on at the moment, but I'm not going to present any results on that today. Okay, so some general background. So there's one main result in the middle of it, embedded in the middle of this. The rest of it's just padding, really, to get us through 45 minutes, or approximately 45 minutes. So I apologize if I sort of insulted your intelligence, or indeed my own intelligence. Okay, so there are a number of different ways of approaching this. There are what I call exact methods. So, for example, with cylinders, one might be tempted to do what I've got in the first line up there, which is to expand your unknown potential in terms of the instant wave plus the superposition over the n cylinders. So I'm just taking out one, if you think about that first diagram where I've got rows going up to infinity in both directions, I've taken advantage of the infinite periodicity to think of just one row of cylinders now from 1 to n, and then I can expand in terms of some local basis functions, multipoles. Okay, and then I've got to apply boundary conditions, and this leads to a fully coupled system of equations. For more general things that aren't cylinders, one might use Green's functions and similarly expand over all of the scatterers and then distribute Green's functions or dipoles associated with Green's functions over the surface of all of the cylinders. And again, you've still got to apply the cylinder boundary condition, and that leads to a coupled system. So these are heavily computationally intensive, especially if you think about n being large. Okay, then there are approximations, and here are two approximations that probably are more. The one I'm more familiar with is low-frequency homogenisation. So this is where you assume that the wavelength has a contrast in length scales, and the wavelength is much larger than the periodicity of the cells. Okay, so you've got, this is your working assumption up here. And the idea is that you take this discrete description of the cylinders, for example, and you replace that by an effective medium. So this is essentially like squinting at the screen and saying, well, it's kind of merged itself out. I don't see all of the cylinders. I just see some gray blur between the left-hand and the right-hand end. Okay, so this demands that you implement a multi-scale expansion. You have a long-range or a macro-scale variable, a micro-scale or a local-scale variable, and that you're periodic on the local scale. So that's the normal underlying assumption that you have with homogenization. And I sort of tend to this later on. Okay, and when you do this, your Helmholtz equation, your governing equation, is going to be replaced by, and all the boundary conditions are going to be lumped together and be replaced by some effective boundary condition, which might take the form of something like this, where these a's are somehow related to adding the inertia coefficients. Okay, and when you do this, anything you've got left to do now is match to the exterior fields at the left-hand and the right-hand boundaries, and this method, of course, is now independent of them. You've just blurred out all of the stuff in between, and you're not concerned with the number of scatterings. Another method might be to say, well, you have actually what you might regard as being small scatterers. So now A, which is the size of the scatter, is small with respect to the cell, and KA is small itself, the wavelength. Much larger than the size of the scatterer. Okay, so I've never used Folger's method, kind of, I've written it down as though I know what I'm talking about here, and you can take me up on this, but you can use some kind of method in which your scattering is characterized by a low order scattering, a low order expansion. Okay, so normally a dipole and a monopole will characterize the scattering by these small scatterings. Okay, so again, this is a fully coupled system, but the interactions are much more simplified, and so this isn't so computationally and demanding. Okay, right, then scattering matrices. There's a reason I'm doing this, right? So I want to make a connection between scattering matrices and something that I've been working on. So scattering matrices are perhaps the most natural way to come at this. So with scattering matrices, you say, well, let's try and work out the propagation characteristics of a single period. Given that this is periodic from left to right, let's exploit the periodicity and let's characterize the scattering by one single period and then glue these together. Okay, so here's my cylinder now. This is just one period. There are other ones to the left and the right in my fully finite periodic array. And I assume that I've got some kind of incoming information and outgoing information on the left-hand boundary, and the same thing is going on the right-hand boundary. Okay, and I'll vectorize them because they may include propagating waves. There may be more than one propagating wave if you're working in waveguides, but they can also capture evanescent effects as well, in general. Right? So this is some kind of modal description or modal decomposition of the solution. Okay, and now this method depends upon where you put these lines, because this method relies upon there being a modal description of the solution that you're after at these particular points. So if you'd have put your periodicity, say, here and halfway through the next cylinder, this would be a much harder task to achieve. The way that I've written it down here, it's obvious to me that you can write this down in terms of separation of variables, and therefore these an plus minuses and bn plus minuses representing waves to the right and waves to the left are naturally part of the solution of this on these two lines. Okay, so if you do this and follow through with the mathematics, you can either write down, you can characterize the scattering in two ways. You can use a scattering matrix in which you relate the incoming information, so this is incoming, outgoing information, or you can use a transfer matrix or a transition matrix in which you say that the waves to the right are related via a matrix, a transfer matrix for the waves to the left. Okay, and of course, this notation here implies that I've got some kind of finite system going on here, and so truncation implies approximation. And the crudest approximation that you might do, or the crudest truncation, would be to truncate so that you only retain the propagating wave. So if this was just a single mode system, this would be a 2x2 matrix because I have single modes coming in and single modes going out. Okay, so in some sense, you can go between something very approximate, what I would call a wide spacing approximation, where you just retain these propagating modes, to something more sophisticated, where you retain lots of information about evanescent modes as well. Okay, so now once you've got one of these things which characterizes waves coming in to the right with waves coming in to the left, you can glue these matrices together. You have to insert a phase matrix because every time you step to the left, you've got an extra phase to take into account due to the coordinate transform, essentially. But essentially, you can glue these together, so you've got a product of transfer matrices connecting the left-hand edge to the right-hand edge of your scattering. And at the left-hand and right-hand edge, you can associate it with incident waves, reflective waves, and transmitted waves. OK, Okay, so now you're in a position to work out R and T, if that's your goal, which it normally is, in terms of essentially stuff that you know about a single cell. Okay, so you can take this a bit further. This is well known. I used this method a few 20 years ago, I think, when looking at a different type of problem, or a similar type of problem, I should say. So you can do a spectral decomposition of the single transfer matrix, so you can diagonalize it and write it in terms of orthogonal matrices. And when you do it like this, so these diagonal matrices can be written as a series of, so these are just the eigenvalues of the transition matrix, and they come in real reciprocal pairs and complex conjugate pairs, as far as I remember, but anyways, they represent propagating and evanescent waves, and the total scattering now can be characterized like this. So I can get some R and T in terms of the incident wave, in terms of the triangular matrix taken to the power N. Okay, so the N is just inserted on in these experiments. So in this, the computational effort now is independent of N. Okay, so this is a good thing. And you can see that if all of the mu j's are not real, as it were, then you want to stop them because none of the information is being propagated through wavelength mode, otherwise you're on the passband. Okay, so this hint, this scattering matrix or transfer matrix formulation hints at something to do with the infinite periodic array, something to do with the Bloch-Floquet problem. Of course, the single cell problem knows nothing about the finite array. You just solve a problem on its own. It doesn't know that there are many things. You just solve it independently. And this thing X, which comes from the spectral decomposition, this indicates some kind of mode coupling. This tells you that somehow the propagating modes are having to be redistributed to get it back onto the modal description that you decided for the problem. Okay, so this is a different approach. So this is a straight-out Bloch-Floquet approach. Again, I'm going to think about a single period in the array. I'm actually thinking about things that are symmetric. I'm having a problem thinking about things that aren't symmetric at the moment because I want certain properties on the eigenvalues of this Bloch-Floquet problem. So I've deliberately written this down as a symmetric problem or a symmetric geometry. And again, I might be thinking about a problem in acoustics. So I've got a wave equation here. I've got Neumann conditions on the cylinder. I've just decided to put, you can put periodic conditions on the top and the bottom, but I've just decided here for simplicity that these are Neumann conditions as well. This is the nth cell of a finite array. Of course, I then supplement these with these Bloch-Floquet conditions. So this tells me how to get from the left hand to the right hand edge from the left hand edge, using a quasi-periodic phase factor. So this, of course, is an eigen problem. It's an eigenvalue problem or a spectral problem. And the problem is to find the beta associated with non-trivial solutions of this problem. Okay, and it turns out that I can't prove this, and that's not my business. I'm a pure mathematician. But it turns out that there are an infinite number of these computationally, and, of course, there are associated eigenfunctions, which I label phi superscript j. And you can show, because of the symmetry that I've assumed here, that the beta j are either real, and you can restrict the range in which they live to this finite range on the real axis, or that they lie on the imaginary axis, okay, or that they lie on a line in the complex plane, which is pi over 2s, that's the far end of this interval, plus a complex or an imaginary value, so it's a complex value in total. Okay, so these betas, these eigenvalues of the spectral problem, live in certain parts of the complex plane. What you can also show is that if beta of j is an eigenvalue, so is minus beta j. So these things appear in plus-minus pairs. And the eigenfunctions themselves aren't identical. Okay? They're sort of the flip of one another. So phi minus j is really a reflection of phi j about the axis, the x-axis here. Again, they're linearly independent from these ones here. So these is a linearly independent set of functions in general. Okay, so I can solve this, right? I can, if you find, you can go to your problem, you can say, right, here's a problem, ellipse, whatever you want to put in here, modulo is symmetric, my caveat at the moment. You can solve these problems using whatever method you choose to use. I mean, ellipse is difficult, but you can solve this numerically using console or whatever it might be, or you may have a simple scatterer that you're looking at. Right, so this is the key. This is the key to making this work. And it's quite straightforward, although its application is not so easy. You apply Green's identity to two of these eigenfunctions, so phi j and phi minus k. Okay, so Green's identity has a domain integral. The domain integral is zero because they both satisfy the same equations with the same boundary conditions. So homogeneous boundary conditions, and you only get contributions on the boundaries to the left and the right, and because of the Bloch-Floquet condition, you can reduce them to conditions to the boundary on one side, and that's even the left-hand side here. You get a prefect here that these beta j's and beta k's are distinct if j is not equal to k. Again, I can't prove that, but it's numerical. And so it turns out that you get this orthogonality relation, right? But this particular combination of eigenfunctions integrated over one side, the left-hand side, is delta jk. Okay, so they're orthogonal in the sense that the integral over the left-hand boundary or the right-hand boundary is zero. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, well, I can write down the solution as an expansion over all of the eigenfunctions. And all of the eigenfunctions are all the positive ones and all of the negative ones. So my general solution in the nth cell now, okay, so the scattering problem, okay, is going to consist of all of these eigenfunctions plus j and all of these functions minus j with some coefficients in front of them. And now I've got to try and glue these cells together because I'm going to try and construct the scattering problem. Okay, so I need to go from the nth cell to the n plus 1 cell, so I need to be able to match the potential and match the velocity, the flux. When I do this, using this orthogonality condition, it turns out that I make these relations. So I make it either details for you, just to believe me. It shows you that there is no mode coupling. Okay, so the jth mode in the nth cell couples with the jth mode in the n plus 1 cell, just with a phase factor associated with each of the eigenvalues of the Bloch problem that you assume that you've worked out. Okay, these go back in the other direction, so these are like forward propagating modes and these are like backward propagating modes. So the point of this is that if you write your solution on the left hand, the first cell in n equals 1 cell in terms of the coefficients cj1 and dj1, you know your solution everywhere. Okay, in fact, you can go all the way up to the nth cell, and they're still written in terms of the coefficients on the first cell. Okay, so the solution is expressed in terms of a single set of coefficients. It's as if the solution itself was a solution to an effective medium equation. It's almost as though you've done homogenization. Okay, that's my claim anyway. And to complete the solution, you just need to match to the two exterior regions to the left and the right of the finite array. Okay, and the computational effort is going to be independent of n, because n is just carried in these phase factors. Okay, so I'm going to do an example. So that's the general theory, or the general setup. I'll just do this example that I suggested I do, which is the water wave problem, and just show you how this works, and compare it to homogenization. Okay, so I'm going to have a wave coming in from the left, be reflected back out to the left. I've got these, this is a cross-section through, you can think of it coming out of the page here. This is the bottom of the ocean. This is the top of the ocean. There's a wave running along the top of the ocean being transmitted beyond this, and I just immerse these vertical barriers. mesh. The problem I'm solving here is Laplace's equation. It doesn't matter, the field equation is kind of irrelevant here. It's got to be linear, of course. I've got a free surface condition, so this allows me to carry waves over the surface, and I've got Neumann conditions on all of the solid surfaces that you see there. And there's some d is the depth of this, and delta is the width of this. In fact, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to assume that d is much larger than delta, so that these are placed very, very close together. I'm actually interested in them being very, very close together, because this defines a water-made metamaterial, and it has some interesting properties. Okay, so it's very natural for me to look at this problem here, an approximation based upon small separation compared to the depth, where you assume that you can separate scales in the horizontal coordinates, okay, certainly within this region here. And when you do that, you'll reduce the effective equation, which I've shaded in grey here, so you can still see the structure drawn on here, but I'm essentially going to blur this out and say that in that region, my Laplace's equation just gets reduced to 5z = 0. This just tells me physically that fluid is only allowed to pump up and down in these channels. Below that, I've still got the incompressible Laplace equation and the experience of that point as well. Okay, so this gives me, this isn't what I've just been telling you about. This is homogenisation now. I'm just going to show you what the solution is with homogenisation. So this is the most natural thing to do. It's the simplest approach, certainly for this approximation. Okay, so now I can write within that grey blurred region the solution everywhere by just doing standard separation of variables. I have some vertical eigenfunctions, which are composite eigenfunctions, because I have to go from the top region to a bottom region. My new j's are roots of a dispersion relation, look like this. And I'm just describing my solution. I've blurred out all of the barriers, and my solution is just in terms of two sets of coefficients. So this dispersion relation is quite interesting, because you can see on the bottom that you get into trouble when the frequency gets high enough that the bottom disappears. In fact, homogenization fails when the length scales fail to separate, and that's associated with this becoming, the denominator here becoming small, and this is associated with resonance in these narrow channels. And then it also implies, if you look at the if you look at this relationship here, it gives you a distribution of roots. Normally, you'd have one real root plus an infinite sequence of roots on the imaginary axis. There are no real roots for high enough frequencies beyond the resonant frequencies. According to this homogenization, I have an infinite step length. Okay, so what am I going to do? I can solve this problem by matching at the left-hand and right-hand ends. So this looks a bit horrendous, and I've written this up for a reason, because it gives me a pair of scalar integral equations. So I'm not afraid of these two equations. These are easy to solve numerically. It goes back to what I did in my PhD thesis, which always makes me happy. Everybody's happy when they end up doing a problem which belongs to their PhD thesis, I think. I'm not speaking for myself. But anyway, you can see I've just said that up here. But, so this is the structure of those integral equations. You can find R and T from that. Okay, so the solution using the Bloch-Floquet approach. How's that going to work out? So now I've solved the exact single cell problem. Okay, so I've put all of the boundary conditions down here that I need to solve. And my free surface condition, the bottom condition, these are the, I've decided to carve out a single cell. And I could have done it in different ways. I've decided to put a single cell to have one barrier to the left and one barrier to the right. These dashed lines mean that these are really matching regions that I'm matching the solution to underneath here and underneath here. And I can solve this using separation of variables. I can separate sideways or vertically, and you get two different solutions and two different representations. The key thing, of course, here is that I'm solving the Bloch-Floquet problem. So this is an eigen problem, and I'm solving for the betas, and there's an infinite number of these betas, and there's negative betas as well. This is a symmetric problem. And there are associated eigenfunctions associated with that. And I can solve for as many of these as I would. Okay, now I use this thing that I just constructed, whereby I said with the Bloch-Floquet problem, if you use a solution at the left-hand end, you use it at the right-hand end, and all you need to do is match. So I've hidden that from you. I've done all of this process of taking that formulation. And when I do this system, this is what I end up with. I end up with a pair of integral equations, which look exactly like the pair of integral equations that you get with homogenization. So my claim here is that this is as simple as getting homogenization, which assumes that you have periodicity, okay, from the left-hand side to the right, if you work on a local scale with periodic boundary conditions. So I claim that this Bloch-Floquet approach has given me a solution which is as simple as homogenization, but I haven't applied periodicity, I've applied the exact Bloch-Floquet periodic boundary conditions, and the solution looks exactly the same. So just to show you, it looks exactly the same as what I had before. These scattered functions are normalized eigenfunctions, because my orthogonality condition that I wrote down before wasn't normalized. I have to normalize these, and you can show, indeed, analytically, that in the limit, as delta over d tends to zero, so I shrink the spacing between these barriers, my betas tend to the mu's, and my block eigenvalues tend to the solution of the homogenized problem, and my eigenfunctions do the same thing. Okay, so I'll finish with some numerical results. This is a comparison, so this is I'm using k as a proxy for the frequency. I've got some depth of submergence, so these barriers are submerged 20% through the depth, that's not an important parameter. And I'm looking essentially at the change in frequency and making some comparisons with the roots of through homogenization and the roots from the eigenvalues of the Bloch-Floquet problem. So here the thing to notice is as I make delta over d smaller, you should see that the curves tend to the black curve, which is the homogenization curve. Kd equals 1 is the awkward point, that's the point at which you switch in homogenization from a pass band to an infinite stop band during this point. For the Bloch-Floquet problem, what happens is the eigenvalues disappear and reach the end of the interval, they reach pi over 2s. And they appear and shoot up the imaginary axis. So they go along the axis and they shoot up very, very quickly. There are imaginary roots as well, and there's a similar comparison here with the first few imaginary roots. So hopefully you can see or be convinced that the Bloch-Floquet eigenvalues are tending to the homogenized eigenvalues. This is what the eigenfunctions look like, and they're plotted over a range rather than just in one cell. And again, I'm now taking delta over d to get smaller, tending towards the homogenized solution. So the homogenized solution doesn't have any barriers in, because that's how it's formulated. And here you can see three barriers, double the number of barriers here, and on top of that, I guess five times the number of barriers here. And you can see how, hopefully, you can see how these solutions are tending towards the homogenized solution. The comparison of, so that's a comparison with homogenization, comparison of this Bloch-Floquet approach that I've been advocating with other methods. So in fact, you don't need n to be large. You can do this with as many barriers as you like. So here I've just, in the first part, I've just got two barriers, so I've got a single cell. Okay, so I'm not extending this over multiple cells, I'm just doing it for a single cell. For two barriers that are different methods, again, deeply going back to my thesis, and you can follow, you can't see, because there are two lines that coincide with one another. And then for a large number of barriers, in my postdoc, he looked at comparing with a scattering matrix approach, the thing that I outlined before, just to convince ourselves that this was working. So again, there's an overlap there. And you can see the effect of this is the critical point, KD equals 1. So this is a kind of multiple scattering effect, which is getting more and more severe as you approach the resonance in the array. Okay, and then finally, comparison of Bloch-Floquet with homogenization. So I've taken a scattering problem now, I'm not just looking at the eigenvalues or eigenfunctions. I've made the width of the arrays equal to the depth of the fluid, so it's a fixed width. And I'm putting more and more barriers in the way because I'm reducing delta, the space in between them. And I hope, again, to converge towards homogenisation. So this picture is a bit of a mess, really, but hopefully, again, you can see that there's a black line associated with homogenisation, and the blue and the red line are tending towards that black line. And then this is the final picture. So this is scattering in a pass band and a stop band. So down here, you're working in pass bands. Up here, so this is the reflection. The reflection is 1, so the transmission is 0. So you take this stop band over here. So below the threshold, I can't remember what exact value is being used here. Somewhere down here, you can see waves coming in and then being transmitted with high amplitude because you're exciting a near resonance in these channels. So a wave comes in, passes through, and then gets transmitted. And in the stop band, the wave comes in and gets reflected back. Okay, and I've finished early, but that's not a problem because we don't have another talk. We just have coffee, right? So I don't have to make something else up now, do I?